You got 5 seconds.
Fandor is proud to be a sponsor at the Sonoma International Film Festival. Thanks to SIFF for 25 years of raising the bar and elevating new talent from around the world. Bringing people together through film, food, wine, and fun. That's our kind of festival. Cheers to a great year for independent cinema.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another edition of the Fandor Video Podcast. My name is Hooman. The guy with the thumbs up is Chris Kelly.
How you doing?
And what's going on,
Hoo? Hey, Brent.
Thumbs up all around, guys. Thumbs up all around.
We're doing a special feature with the Sonoma Film Festival where we're highlighting a bunch of their filmmakers and movies that are going to be at the Sonoma Film Festival. Our first guest, his name is Brian. Is it Lilla?
That's it.
All right. Good and job. Brian has a film called Children of the Vine. First of all, welcome Brian to the show. Tell us a little bit about yourself and then tell us what your movie's about.
About myself, I live in Napa. I've been making films for about 22 years and started off making skate movies and surf films. And then now I find myself at a juncture where I'm taking on one of the biggest companies in the world.
And that all has to do with Children of the Vine, correct?
Correct. Yeah. Oh. It's a big investigation on the herbicide Roundup and its impact on people's health, not just children's health.
So tell us what your film shows. Tell us what you're revealing to the audience as a result of this weed killer.
Sure. The backstory is I found out by living in wine country, they use a ton of Roundup. And I started seeing these reports about Napa County and Sonoma County having the highest cancer rates in California for children. And I thought, what the hell? And I just happened to have two kids. And when I looked into it, all the oncologists said, you know, you can't prove that, you know, Roundup is causing all these cancers. That's a big 10 to 20 year study. And so I decided, okay, I'll scrap that idea. But then I just started diving into what is Roundup and how is it affecting public health, and come to find out that we have sort of this silent health epidemic going on where kids have just had massive amounts of chronic disease for the last 40 years. And a lot of it's being traced back to their exposure to Roundup and its primary active ingredient, glyphosate. So that's what I've been working on for the last 6 years.
And you chose this topic just because you have kids and just because you live in Napa, or were there any other reasons?
Now, that was pretty much it. You know, I've done a lot of other documentaries where I'll travel and I'll go away. And as soon as I had my first daughter, I told my wife, I said, you know, whatever story I pick next, I'm going to do it close to home so I don't have to be away. And then as soon as I started finding out about these cancer reports, I was like, well, screw it. I'll figure out what's going on here. It's in my own backyard, and that was the motivation, really.
Well, I mean, something that you wish weren't close to home.
No doubt, man.
All right. So tell us about the filmmaking process. Like, how long has it been? What's the hardest thing you've had to deal with? If you don't mind, share your budget. Have you had any death threats? Like, I want to hear it all.
Yeah.
Montana lawyer stories are always interesting. So
everyone says that. I ran into some people yesterday and they're like, what's up with your film? And I'm like, has Monsanto issued any death threats? I've heard that probably from 20 people, and the answer is no. Okay. Not at all. I do have some good legal people behind me, but I've been working on it for 6 years. And one of the reasons it took so long was that prior to having kids, anytime I'd make a film, I just put my head down and do it. All of a sudden, I found myself being a full-time parent and filmmaking and doing commercial work to you know, pay the bills. So it took a lot longer. And then you throw a pandemic on top of it all, and it's like, shit, right, this is taking way too long. But the good news is that because it took longer, the story really flushed itself out, and I was able to actually get to, you know, some of the top scientists and people that have been working on this for a long time.
Okay, so what's the hardest thing in terms of the filmmaking process that you had to deal with this movie?
The hardest aspect of this story is that it's so big. It's like this Pandora's box. You know, as soon as I go in to say, well, how much Roundup is being used in the US, and then you start looking at the Midwest, the Central Valley, it just goes on and on and on. And then you get all these lobby groups involved and these science groups. And it's just this Pandora's box that never stops. And the biggest challenge for me was, how do I simplify this thing down so that, you know, it's contained in 90 minutes and I'm only telling the most important chapters of this story. And what I decided was, is that I wasn't going to interview a ton of people. I shot only a total of 12 interviews for the project. I only used 10 of them. And so it really just kind of simplified the story as to what is Roundup? What is the misleading propaganda that Monsanto has been putting out there for 40 years saying it's safe as table salt? And what are the scientists saying? And then how is this like unveiling itself in terms of its impact on public health?
So in 2022, is Roundup still being used?
Extensively.
Oof.
Extensively in the U.S. The U.S. uses more Roundup than any other country in the world. So we're seeing countries all over the world banning it.
Except
Mexico has banned it, Colombia, the Netherlands, France, Russia, Ukraine, ironically. They grow some of the best crops in the world because they see the long-term impact on public health.
You think Gavin's going to ban Roundup?
I mean, look, I would imagine that there are both EPA and Cal EPA investigations ongoing, and some of which I'm sure are reported on in the movie. We'll see what happens. It is kind of stunning that there's been a lot of other worldwide regulatory action against Roundup at this point. There hasn't been in the U.S.
True. Brian.
Yes.
What's your hope? What's the ultimate dream that you're wanting after people see this movie?
The whole purpose behind it is just to generate dialogue because, you know, when we went up against Big Tobacco, that was a 50-year fight to finally get that little warning label on the cigarette package that says, you know, warning, may cause cancer.
Mm. You want the same thing?
What's that?
You want the same thing for Roundup? You want that label?
I want that same label, and I just want people thinking about like, well, what else can I do? Because it's possible to grow like crops at a scale to where we don't need this stuff. And the solutions are there. And that's a big part of the movie is that, you know, I bring up all these questions around, you know, well, what's the problem with Roundup? And then I also bring in what the solutions are. So I feel like we can get there. The big problem is that the EPA, they're not going to backtrack and go back and say, oh, you know what? We should have put a warning label, or maybe we shouldn't even have allowed this stuff 40 years ago. Mm. So that's what we're going up against.
So do you know the wineries in Napa and Sonoma and St. Helena that use Roundup?
It's easy to tell. All you got to do is. Oh, yeah. When you drive through wine country and you look over at the vineyards and you see these perfect little manicured strips right under the vines, these little brown strips where you see nothing growing. And then they have weeds all around it on the other sides. That's Roundup.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, what day and time is your film playing at the Sonoma Film Festival?
Yeah, so the big news is it's having its world premiere on March 24th at 11:30 a.m. And then they're going to do another screening on March 26th at 11:30 a.m. as well.
Wow.
All right.
Well, listen, Brian, let's end with this. Tell us movies that inspire you. Give us two or three films and why.
Sure. Number one's Apocalypse Now. I watch it every year. I think it's one of the greatest movies ever made. I love it. It's kind of a hero story, but it's also kind of an anti-hero story. And as I get older, I feel like I can just kind of really appreciate the whole story around people with PTSD, because that's kind of the backbone of that story.
Yeah.
Both in Marlon Brando's character and Martin Sheen. And then second film actually is Eleanor Coppola, his wife made, Hearts of Darkness, A Filmmaker's Apocalypse, which was the documentary about her husband, Francis, making the movie.
Yeah.
And I think she did a phenomenal job of just like showing, you know, how torturous it was to make that movie and how dark it was.
Yeah.
And then the last one I'll end up is for documentaries is definitely Hoop Dreams by Steve James. You know, his commitment to that project and those kids. I think he spent like 6 years tracking these kids and their basketball.
Yeah, still extraordinarily admired as a doc and as an overall film.
Totally. I mean, what a commitment.
Yep.
Brian, if people want to get in touch with you or learn more about the film, where can they go?
The website, childrenofthevinemovie.com.
All right, my man. We wish you nothing but the best. Congratulations on your world premiere at Sonoma. And we're hoping to be up there. So if we're up there, let's definitely hang.
Yeah, definitely. Give me a shot. Thanks for letting me be on the show.
Of course.
Thanks,
man.
Brian. Thanks, have a good Brian. One.
Take care, you guys.
You got 5 seconds.
Fandor is proud to be a sponsor at the Sonoma International Film Festival. Thanks to SIFF for 25 years of raising the bar and elevating new talent from around the world. Bringing people together through film, food, wine, and fun. That's our kind of festival. Cheers to a great year for independent cinema.